and welcome to The Real Politik. This week, the Prime Minister rarely speaks, but when he did address a press conference, it was a pre-scripted headline he wanted to leave behind. On his opting out of the Prime Ministerial race for 2014 and his scathing attack on Narendra Modi. It was only his third press conference in his two terms as Prime Minister. But Dr. Manmohan Singh had pre-scripted the political headlines that he wanted to leave behind, starting with an announcement that he was ready to pass on the baton, even preempting any question from the media on his retirement.
After the general election, I will hand the baton over to a new Prime Minister.
Paving the way for Rahul Gandhi to don the mantle.
Rahul Gandhi has outstanding credentials to be nominated as the presidential candidate.
But it was his tirade against Modi that has started a debate amongst political experts on whether it was deliberate.
By strong Prime Minister, you mean that you preside over the mass massacre of innocent citizens in the streets of Ahmedabad. That is the measure of strength. I do not believe that sort of strength this country needs. Without discussing the merits of Mr. Narendra Modi, I sincerely believe that it would be disastrous for the country to have Narendra Modi as the Prime Minister.
But if the Congress was indeed fighting the perception against it of a government written with corruption, the Prime Minister's reply to Times Now question was ambiguous at best.
Veerbhadra Singh sitting in cabinet meetings deciding on issues that are related to a company when his family and he himself have business involvement with that company. Do you think that's proper?
I have seen some newspapers reports, but I haven't had the time to apply my mind to it about what is the truth in these allegations.
Is this the reason why the Prime Minister is hoping that history will judge him more favourably than contemporary media has? Or is the Prime Minister bailing himself out of the blame before elections, before accepting any responsibility for wrongdoings during his term? Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, Member of Parliament from Rajya Sabha and a leading lawyer, whose legal arguments often leave his opponents completely stumped. Nirmala Sitharaman, an expert in international studies from the Jawaharlal Nehru University, now is a fiery debater and spokesperson of the BJP. The question that we are asking is, in his press conference, was the Prime Minister trying to defend his own record or did he convey the Congress's resolve to fight corruption and anti-incumbency in the forthcoming elections of 2014? Joining us, Nirmala Sitharaman and Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi. My question first goes to Dr. Singhvi. Dr. Singhvi, the press conference really looked like the Prime Minister was defending his own record rather than showing that it was a battle-ready Congress party ready to go into 2014.
I think that's a misinterpretation, Navika, for the simple reason that the Prime Minister, his record as a UPA government, the Congress-led UPA government and the Congress party, these are not separable compartments. His record and his government's performance is what the UPA government is all about. Secondly, I think it's important that the Prime Minister, unlike the person whose people have been criticizing him since yesterday before the presser, and this is very surprising, you've had preemptive statements and virtual preemptive press conferences by the BJP, which shows their fear and insecurity, to try and attack the Prime Minister before his press conference. Just like Mr. Modi did on Independence Day to hold a parallel Independence Day speech. And I think the Prime Minister has spoken with candor, with humility, with transparency, with openness, and most importantly, as he always does, with facts, figures, specificity, programs. Unfortunately, Navika, and I may be wrong, of course, but I clearly believe that the person who is attacking the Prime Minister and getting him attacked since yesterday and all the time speaks with ambiguity. He speaks with the taunting denouncement, denunciation, divisiveness, and creates an insightful atmosphere.
Nirmala, my question to you is, do you agree that this was the Prime Minister who was talking about taking responsibility for the allegations of corruption against his government? Was this a Prime Minister who was taking responsibility for having completely failed to solve the issue of inflation that has cost them the recent assembly election? Did you feel that it was a Prime Minister who was only talking about his own self-record being clean, but when it comes to collective responsibility of his cabinet as the head of the cabinet, he was passing the buck on, Nirmala?
Yes, undoubtedly. The Prime Minister's press conference has only revealed that he was finding answers to excuse himself of responsibility. Of responsibility to take action where corruption happened, he happily moved it over to UPA once term and absolved himself of all responsibility because he won another term, 2009. And as regards, failure to implement policies which they promised, 6,000 crores has been spent on Ganga purification, which they themselves declared just before election in 2009 as a national river project. But nothing has moved in that. Where is that money gone? Today there was a cursory mention on skill development. On skill development itself, I'd like to ask the Prime Minister, 2008 he forms a council, then that very time he forms a board. Later on he goes on further to say 2011 I appoint an advisor. And by 13, nothing has happened except for another board which has been formed, which is going to be the coordination.
Nirmala, come to the specific issue of corruption, inflation. These were the two major issues that Rahul Gandhi had pointed out as reasons why they lost the recent assembly elections. Was the Prime Minister taking responsibility for that, or was he passing the buck?
He was clearly passing the buck. He wasn't taking any responsibility.
Navika.
Yes, Dr. Singhvi.
Navika, unlike Mr. Modi's speeches, which are only full of rhetoric and adjectives. They have nothing specific, facts, figures, programs. They denounce and they taunt and they divide and they create an atmosphere of anger. Dr. Manmohan Singh has been very candid. He was humble and straightforward in saying that I am ruling myself out for the next round. He was categorical in saying, yes, we have not been able to control inflation the way we would have liked to. He was clear in saying that while we have taken more concrete action in respect of corruption everywhere, it is true that people tend to be perceptually associating certain things. So I think this is a very clear candidate's usual style. He's not ambiguous or vacuous or vague, as some people deliberately try to be. After all, if you see the whole line of Mr. Modi's speeches, he's very good at rhetoric and at creating a certain denunciatory atmosphere, taunting. But where are the specifics? This was a press conference of specifics.
There were absolutely no specific responses, Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi. There was a specific question on corruption that was asked. There was a specific question that was asked that ministers are not supposed to attend cabinet meetings and they're supposed to declare to the Prime Minister their business interests in companies. And a question was asked about the recent example of Veer Bhadra Singh, a Congress chief minister in Himachal Pradesh. The Prime Minister has received a complaint from the leader of opposition in Rajya Sabha, Arun Jaitley, but the Prime Minister said he had not applied his mind to it. Now, that's not a specific reply.
Why? Let me deal with it straight away. As far as Mr. Veer Bhadra Singh is concerned, the allegations are in the public domain for the last 4 days. The Prime Minister doesn't deal with states. He said he received a reply and forwarded it. What he's saying is he's not judging it. He doesn't really have a jurisdiction to deal with it at the state level. But he has forwarded it, he hasn't hidden it or he hasn't avoided it. All he's saying is that I'm not taking a decision on the merits because it doesn't really come into my immediate domain. And as far as other things are concerned, he was very candid on inflation. He was very candid on the record on corruption, but he said that we don't accept.
Dr. Singhvi, he could have said that the matter is being examined by the CBI. He could have said that I've passed on the investigation to another department, but that's not what he said. He said he had not applied his mind.
No, Navika, of course, he says he has not applied his mind to the merits of the investigation and there is no question of the CBI being directed by him to investigate. He is not suggesting that he is accepting Mr. Arun Jaitley's thing and starting an investigation. All he is saying is that there is an ongoing investigation. I forwarded it through the PMO. Where is he avoiding it? I mean, what should he say? The Prime Minister, what should he say about the Chief Minister's situation? At the most, it is for the party to deal with. And since the last 3 or 4 days, the Congress has very categorically dealt with the allegations. Mr. Jaitley threw a challenge, and I was on television yesterday and day before. He said, let's debate this in public. And I debated it. And I'm prepared to debate it with Nirmala ji today.
The larger point, Dr. Singhvi, really here being that if this is a government, if this is a Prime Minister whose personal record is very clean, whose personal integrity is very high, should he be looking at issues of corruption more strongly than he appeared to look at today from his answers? That's the question that I posed to Nirmala Sitharaman. Nirmala, would you have expected a more forthright answer from the Prime Minister?
Absolutely. Particularly, I'm glad you took the example of Sri Veerabhadra saying, here is the leader of the opposition from Rajya Sabha writing with a complete set of documents and evidences attached and enclosed about a minister who had to be removed from the central cabinet. And the Congress party thought it fit to send him as chief minister to Himachal Pradesh. But on whom, when the leader of the opposition writes, after a few days, today, whenever the Prime Minister had seen the letter, we hear him say that he has not applied his mind yet. It is a serious issue, a serious charge, which the leader of the opposition is posing and writing to him directly with all the evidentiary material. And on that, look at the way in which the Prime Minister responded on a minister who had to be removed earlier on corruption charges from the central cabinet. The Congress party and the Prime Minister have not shown any seriousness in handling corruption.
Dr. Singhvi, quick rebuttal to Nirmala.
I think all this waxing eloquent by the leader of the opposition and the BJP getting hysterical, I think you should ask a few simple questions. Were they half as hysterical about Babubhai Bhukeria, who is convicted of a serious charge and continues to be a minister sitting in the council for months in Gujarat? And Mr. Purushottam Solanki, again convicted, for whom sanction for prosecution at a later stage was denied by the Gujarat chief minister.
But Dr. Singhvi, two wrongs don't make a right.
Agreed.
And this time we were asking a question of the Prime Minister of the country, which is different from asking a question to the opposition of the country.
Agreed.
As the Prime Minister, there is more responsibility at his doorstep than at the doorstep of any opposition leader.
Agreed. Therefore, that is why, unlike Mr. Modi and unlike the BJP, in Tehelka, in George Fernandes, in Babubhai Bhukeria, what the Congress has done is, you've had ministers like Raja losing their seat, you've had Mr. Ashok Chavan resigning even before an FIR, you've had a reference, which is an ongoing investigation, both by CBI and the IT against Mr. Veerabhadra Singh, after which he has, by the way, won an election. So that's the difference, of course. Investigations go on. There is a reference. We don't behave like the BJP, who tries to cover up, who tries to bring back Mr. Yedurappa after he left screaming and fighting after 1 year's gap. 1 year's gap it took him to go.
There are two answers I would want to give him on this. First thing, the comparisons that he's bringing of Babubhai Bhukeria or anybody else is completely wrong. He's a senior advocate in Supreme Court. Doesn't he know that the case is sub judice and the earlier order which was passed was even removed from the court? He's gone for a clear appeal, and therefore he's completely not yet, we've not heard the final word on that. That's
not
one
accused,
thing. And second, on Yediyurappa ji, let Dr. Singhvi know that the High Court itself, with the two-judge bench, very clearly quashing that he has not been given a fair hearing by the Santosh Hegde Lokayukta, and that FIR was quashed. So let him not please bring that in, because he is not telling the full truth. And Mr. Yediyurappa is coming into the party as a karyakarta, and I don't think you should now make a big scene out of it. Considering that when Veerabhadra Singh was removed out of the cabinet, from the central cabinet, sending him blatantly, and also today in Karnataka, inducting two people
after
who are equally tainted,
pending,
about whom the Congress has no moral authority. And again, Adarsh, cherry picking on Adarsh even after Rahul Gandhi had said you have to reconsider, all shows very clearly that the Congress party is only shielding the corrupt rather than even facing the law.
Clearly, questions of corruption allegations against the two national parties, the Congress and the BJP, is something that will continue to go on. We'll slip into a short break. When we come out, we'll discuss the question of whether whether the Prime Minister, after announcing his retirement, has become a lame duck Prime Minister for the remaining 4 months that are still left in his tenure. Welcome back. And the question really, Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, is that already there are dual power centers, or really three power centers in your party, in your government. There is the Prime Minister, but there is also the Congress President Sonia Gandhi, and there is the Vice President Rahul Gandhi, both as independent power centers in the Congress party. Now that the Prime Minister has announced his desire not to be in the race for the Prime Ministerial post of 2014, what happens between January and May of 2014, when he becomes even more of a lame duck Prime Minister? He's already been called a weak Prime Minister. Do you think now he's lost his authority in the remaining period?
I think it's a good devil's question to ask, Navika, but it has absolutely no sequitur at all. First of all, this Prime Minister, with identical allegation about dual authority, remote control, government is going to fall in 3 months. This government, this UPA, this Prime Minister, this Congress President have been there for 10 years now. It's exactly what I heard in September of 2004, the BJP going hysterical, and you've seen the answer by the electorate for 10 years. Number two, do you suggest that if a Prime Minister is candid and humble and straightforward, and he has said so earlier that the mandate was not for me, but I am there, if he says that he rules himself out, do you think he's in it only so that he can be a Prime Minister again in 2014? And therefore, he'll be a lame duck now. I mean, that reasoning doesn't gel at all. Why should a person be lame duck? He has conducted the government for 10 years. And you have an election coming around the corner. In any case, nearer an election, and from February or so, with a model code of conduct. In that sense, the whole country is lame duck, because major policy decisions don't take place. But why this new added thing? And I want to say the third thing. Nirmala ji wants us to believe 3 minutes ago that Babulal Bukharia, having been convicted, continues as a council of minister conviction in a criminal case because he has filed an appeal. Isn't that an amazing statement? If you read Justice Hegde's 1,000-page report, you'll get to know about Mr. Yedurappa. Accepting of money in his son's trusts. Mr. Advani, Mr. Modi and Mr. Jaitley and others have continuously badgered the Prime Minister with words like night watchman. And if he says that Mr. Modi is disastrous for the country, they say these are very bad words by the Prime Minister. What kind of double standards are these?
That's the point. The Prime Minister's called that Modi will be disastrous for the country, and these are comments that the BJP has taken objection to. Nirmala Sitharaman, do you see somewhere this as the Maut Ka Saudagar moment for Narendra Modi? Do you think these comments are going to be used by the BJP once again for electoral benefits, rather than allow them to be passed on as just pure rhetoric made by the Prime Minister?
A Prime Minister is the Prime Minister for the country. I was completely let down when in the press conference the Prime Minister spoke of a constitutional authority, the Chief Minister who's been elected 3 times and who's not been found fault with by the courts. He calls him with the kind of expressions which Srimati Sonia Gandhi used in the 2007 elections in Gujarat, and for which the people of Gujarat punished them squarely, and till today they are not able to come back. Prime Minister of the country holds a position of respect and dignity, and here we find him using expressions which are not even said in the court. It's astonishing that he chose to use these kind of words against a Chief Minister.
Dr. Singhvi, that's the point. The courts, according to BJP, have exonerated Modi so far. He's been under scrutiny of the courts, of the SIT, of various commissions, but they have not found anything against him. Why would the Prime Minister call him disastrous for the country?
That's
the objection the BJP has raised.
Why not? It's a very clear political statement. I can say it, a lot of congressmen say it, the BJP would be disastrous and Mr. Modi would be disastrous. We believe he is a divisive figure, nothing to do with court judgments.
So when we call, Navika, let me just stop Dr. Singhvi there.
I'll tell you why. He has a certain ideology.
So when we call the Prime Minister thinking, lame duck, that and when we call the Prime Minister as having failed the economy,
now, he gets very worked up.
Nirmala, Dr. Singhvi is saying it's a question of ideology.
Let me complete.
It's a question of ideology.
No, I'm saying I'm entitled to say as a Congress party that we believe that Modi will be disastrous. I am saying very clearly that the Congress is entitled to, the Congress has said, and let me repeat it, the BJP and the Mr. Modi would be disastrous for the country. They have not a hope in hell in coming to power, but Mr. Modi otherwise is a divisive figure. He is a person with an ideology which is not suitable to this country, and he is someone who has a certain belief, a thrust, which is completely alien to the inclusive culture of this country. And that's all I'm saying. That's the substance of what the Prime Minister said.
Well, Dr. Singhvi seems to be putting on a lot of charges on the BJP about which I've answered. But what I raise as question is, in a press conference when the Prime Minister, who's holding a position of power, who did not act on corruption, who went about saying it happened during UPA 1 and absolves himself of every responsibility because he's been re-elected, use the same mapdand, use the same measuring rod and say, after 2002, Modi ji has been elected 3 times over. Would he want to absolve him? No. But Modi ji, upar se, answered every question of the SIT, went through the process, SIT, and after that the Supreme Court, and absolved himself of all the accusations. But what about the Colgate? Did the Prime Minister ever answer any question?
Whether it is the Congress party which is not interested in addressing corruption, or whether it is the BJP which has its own track record given the return of Yediyurappa, is a question that the jury is still out on. Is this the reason because of this one-on-one battle between the two national parties that parties like the Aam Aadmi Party have come out to become the major option for people in urban centres? That's a question that both national parties will need to keep their eyes on in the elections of 2014, because this time the battle is not just going to be two-cornered. Will there be a third corner spoiling the entire fight between the two national parties? That's all we have for you this week on The Real Politik. Next week, more such issues, more such debates on the real issue of politics.